If you start intermittent fasting without knowing these 7 mistakes, you will fail. I'm certain of it. Not because fasting doesn't work, not because you lack willpower, but because these mistakes sabotage your results, sometimes before your body even has a chance to adapt. And here's the painful truth. You can fast for 16 hours a day, every day, for weeks, and see little to no results. Worse yet, you might even gain weight, lose energy, and harm your metabolism. How? By making one or more of these critical mistakes. Here are the 7 critical mistakes that could be the reason behind your intermittent fasting failure, along with key tips to maximize the benefits of your fasting. No miracle promises, no dubious testimonials, just pure science and strategies you can apply starting today. Because fasting can transform your health, but if done wrong, it can also sabotage your metabolism, your energy, and even your relationship with food. And point number 5, it could literally save your results. So stay until the end. Because what you're about to discover could make the difference between giving up on day 3 and transforming your metabolic health for good. If this kind of content resonates with you, give me a like, a boost, and subscribe. Let's get started. Mistake number 1, giving up when your body lies to you in the first 3 days. Here's the fatal mistake many beginners make. They feel intense hunger on day 2, panic, give up, and conclude, "Fasting isn't for me." Wrong. It's not that fasting doesn't work. It's that your body's lying to you. Let me explain what's really happening in your body. For years, maybe decades, you've trained your body to expect energy every 3 to 4 hours. Every time your blood sugar dips slightly, your brain sends a signal. Hey, it's time to eat. This is called conditioned hunger. It's not that your body lacks energy, you have reserves to last for weeks. It's just your metabolic clock saying, it's the usual time. Studies from Yale University have shown that ghrelin, the hunger hormone, follows a predictable circadian cycle. It spikes at the times you usually eat, even if you ate just 2 hours ago. But here's the good news. This cycle reprograms itself in 3 to 5 days. Your body is incredibly adaptable. What you need to do, for the first 3 days when hunger strikes, ask yourself, do I really need energy, or is this just habit? Drink water, tea, or black coffee. Wait 20 minutes. In 80% of cases, the feeling fades. Because here's what's fascinating. After 3 to 4 days, your body shifts to fat oxidation as its primary energy source. And then the cravings naturally disappear. But if you give up on day 2 thinking, fasting isn't for me, you'll never reach that tipping point. Now that you know how to handle those critical first 3 days, let's talk about another massive mistake I see all the time. Mistake number 2, starting too aggressively instead of progressing gradually. Here's the mistake many highly motivated beginners make. They think if 16 hours is good, then 20 hours is even better. And they dive straight into extreme fasting on day 1. Bad idea. Your body isn't a machine you can reprogram overnight. It needs time to develop the enzymes necessary for efficient fat oxidation. Research published in Cell Metabolism showed that gradual adaptation produces better long-term results than drastic changes. Why? Because when you jump straight to 18 or 20 hours of fasting without preparation, you stress your system, your cortisol spikes, your energy crashes, and you create the exact conditions that lead to giving up. It's like trying to run a marathon without training. Technically possible, but you'll suffer unnecessarily. Here's a smart progression plan. Weeks 1 to 2, fast 12-12. 12 hours fasting, 12 hours eating. Weeks 3 to 4, move to 14/10. Week 5, plus, go to 16/8 if you feel good. This gradual approach allows your body to adapt without excessive cortisol stress, dramatic energy dips, or uncontrollable cravings. And guess what? You're far more likely to stick with it long-term, because fasting isn't a 2-week sprint. It's a lifestyle. Now let's talk about the mistake that literally sabotages all your efforts, even if you're fasting perfectly. Mistake number 3, breaking your fast with the wrong foods. Listen closely, because this mistake can undo most of your fasting benefits in 30 minutes. Here's what many people do. They fast for 18 hours, feel proud, then break their fast with sugary cereal, white bread, or worse, a big fast food meal. And then everything falls apart. Let me explain why this is catastrophic. During fasting, your body enters autophagy, a deep cellular cleanup process. Your insulin sensitivity improves, your inflammation decreases. It's beautiful. But when you break your fast, your body is in a hyper-receptive metabolic state. It's like a sponge, absorbing everything you give it. If you feed it refined carbs and sugar, you trigger a massive insulin spike. All that beautiful insulin sensitivity you built, wasted in minutes. A study from the University of Alabama showed that the metabolic benefits of intermittent fasting are strongly tied to the nutritional quality during your eating window. What you need to do, break your fast with quality protein and vegetables. Protein stabilizes blood sugar and boosts satiety. Vegetable fiber slows absorption and feeds your microbiome. Here's a concrete example. Eggs with leafy greens or fish with an avocado salad. Simple, effective, metabolically smart. Save carbs for later in your eating window when your insulin sensitivity is already stabilized. Because here's the brutal truth. You can't outfast a bad diet. Fasting amplifies the effects of what you eat, for better or worse. Now let's talk about an aspect almost everyone overlooks, but it can make or break your results. Mistake number four, neglecting hydration and electrolytes. Here's the silent mistake many beginners make. They think fasting just means not eating. They drink a little water when they're thirsty, and that's it. Massive mistake. Because here's what you might not know. It's not just about water volume. It's about electrolytes. During fasting, your body doesn't get water from food, and food normally accounts for about 20% of your daily hydration intake. So you need to actively compensate. But it gets worse. When you fast, especially beyond 16 hours, your insulin stays low. That's great for fat burning. But insulin also plays a role in sodium retention by the kidneys. Low insulin equals more sodium excreted, equals potential electrolyte imbalance. And guess what happens when your electrolytes are out of balance? Fatigue, headaches, dizziness, muscle cramps. Exactly the symptoms people blame on. Fasting not working for them when it's just an electrolyte issue. The solution is simple but critical. Add a pinch of unrefined sea salt to your water. Not regular table salt, high-quality sea salt with trace minerals. Drink bone broth during your fast. Yes, small amounts are technically allowed. Consider a magnesium and potassium supplement, especially if you fast regularly. Research shows that maintaining optimal electrolyte balance can reduce fasting side effects by about 70%. Your energy stays stable, your focus stays sharp, and you avoid the crashes that make many people quit. And now we've reached point number five, the one I mentioned at the start, the one that could literally save your results. Listen closely. Mistake number five, ignoring the circadian timing of your fast. Here's a truth you won't hear everywhere. The quality of your sleep and the timing of your fast directly determine your success. And I'm not just talking about getting enough sleep. I'm talking about the timing and quality of your sleep in relation to your fasting window. Let me share something many people don't know. Fasting from 8 p.m. to 12 p.m. is metabolically superior to fasting from midnight to 4 p.m., even if both are 16 hours. Why think of your body as a factory operating in two modes? Day mode, the factory is running at full speed. All machines are on. It's the perfect time to receive and process energy. Night mode, the factory slows down. It's time for cleaning, repairs, and rest. If you eat late at night, you force the factory to keep running when it should be cleaning and repairing. Result, the work is done poorly, waste builds up, and the next day the factory starts tired. But if you stop eating early in the evening, you let the factory do its nighttime work properly. And the next morning, when you break your fast, the factory is ready, efficient, and burns everything perfectly. That's working with your biological clock instead of fighting it. A groundbreaking study from the Salk Institute showed that eating late at night disrupts your circadian clock and reduces the metabolic benefits of fasting. Even if the total fasting duration is the same, why? Because your insulin sensitivity is naturally higher in the morning and gradually decreases throughout the day. But there's more. Poor sleep increases cortisol, the stress hormone. High cortisol makes you insulin resistant, increases cravings, and makes fasting much harder. It's a vicious cycle. You fast with poor sleep, you're stressed and hungry, and you give up. The winning strategy, stop eating at least 3 hours before bed. This improves sleep quality and counts toward your fasting hours. Aim for 7 to 8 hours of quality sleep. Try breaking your fast in the morning or early afternoon when your insulin sensitivity is optimal. People who optimize this timing see results 3 times faster than those who fast with poor circadian timing. That's the secret of point number 5. Now that you understand the importance of timing, let's talk about a question some people have. Can I exercise during my fast? Mistake number 6, training intensely while fasting without being adapted. Here's the mistake super motivated people make. They decide to start fasting and train fasted on day 1, thinking more stress, more results, wrong. Here's what the science actually says. Training fasted can indeed increase fat oxidation during exercise. A study in the British Journal of Nutrition showed a 20% increase in fat burning during moderate intensity cardio while fasting. Sounds great, right? But wait, there's a catch. If you do intense training, HIIT, heavy lifting, sprints, while fasting without being metabolically adapted, you risk catabolizing your muscles. Your body, low on glycogen, will look for energy wherever it can, including your muscle proteins. Result, you lose muscle instead of burning fat, the exact opposite of what you want. Here's the smart strategy, phase 1, weeks 1 to 4. Don't train fasted. Let your body adapt to fasting first. Phase 2, month 2 plus, gradually introduce light cardio while fasting. Brisk walking, easy cycling. Phase 3, month 3 plus. If you're well adapted, you can try intense training fasted, but listen to your body. And here's a powerful hack. If you train during your fast, consider 5 to 10 grams of branched-chain amino acids, BCAAs, just before. Technically, this slightly interrupts autophagy, but it protects your muscles during intense training. It's a trade-off many find worthwhile. But the golden rule, never add a new stress, intense fasted training, before mastering the first stress, fasting itself. And finally, let's talk about the psychological mistake that makes the difference between those who succeed long-term and those who give up for good. Mistake number 7, giving up permanently after a single slip-up. Here's the fatal psychological mistake that can ruin everything. One Saturday night, you have dinner with friends, you eat outside your fasting window, you break your protocol, and the next morning you wake up thinking, I've ruined everything. What's the point of continuing? And you quit completely, permanently. Stop. Here's what you need to understand. Breaking your fast once does not ruin your progress. It's the guilt and abandonment that follow that ruin everything. Let me explain why this all or nothing mindset is deadly. Most people see fasting as a strict rule. Either you do it perfectly or you fail. There's no gray area. So as soon as they slip up a family meal, a birthday, an emotional emergency, they feel guilty. And instead of just picking back up the next day, they quit entirely. It's like missing one gym session and deciding to never exercise again. That makes no sense, right? A fascinating study from the University of Toronto showed that people who adopt a flexible approach to fasting have a 60% higher long-term success rate than those who are rigid. Why? Because life is unpredictable. There will be events, unexpected moments, times when you have to eat outside your window. And a health tool that doesn't adapt to your real life is a tool you'll inevitably abandon. Here's the winning mindset. Intermittent fasting isn't a religion. It's not an absolute law. It's a flexible tool you use to improve your health. If you have an important dinner on a Friday night that breaks your fasting window, go for it. Enjoy. Without guilt. Because success isn't measured by one day's perfection. It's measured by consistency over weeks, months, years. What to do when you break your fast? Zero guilt. Guilt serves no purpose. It only sabotages your motivation. Pick back up the next day, exactly where you left off. No need to compensate with a longer fast or punish yourself. If you need a break, take a full weekend off fasting, then ease back in. Success isn't in perfection. Success is in flexible consistency over the long term. So stop sabotaging yourself with this all or nothing mindset. A slip up isn't failure. It's just life happening, and that's it. You now know the 7 mistakes that cause many people to fail at intermittent fasting. Conclusion, there you have it. The 7 critical mistakes that sabotage many people trying intermittent fasting. Let's recap quickly. Don't give up when your body lies to you in the first 3 days. Progress gradually instead of rushing. Break your fast with the right foods. Never neglect hydration and electrolytes. Align your fast with your circadian rhythm. Don't train intensely while fasting without being adapted. Adopt a flexible, not all or nothing mindset. If you apply these 7 principles, you won't be among those who give up. You'll be among the few who truly transform their health with intermittent fasting. But here's my final question for you. Are you really going to apply this knowledge, or will you forget it in 2 hours? Because knowledge without action is worthless. So here's what I propose. In the comments, simply write "ready" if you commit to applying at least 3 of these 7 principles this week. Just ready. According to research by Dr. Gail Matthews, writing down your goals increases your chances of success by 42%, and making them public, for example, to a friend, boosts your results even further. And if this video brought you value, if you learned even one thing you didn't know, give it a like and a boost. It helps the algorithm share this science-based information with more people who need it. Subscribe if you want more science-backed content. No nonsense, no miracle promises, just strategies that actually work. And I'll see you in the next video. Until then, take care of yourself. And remember, fasting is a powerful tool. Use it wisely.